Good evening. I think it's a tribute first to Taxsutra and Arun, and I think to the general state of taxation in India that at 5 o'clock on Saturday, you can still have 50, 60 people sitting to listen to tax litigation. So I think a tribute really to everyone who's here. Much of what you've heard over the last 2 days actually could be summated into two key thoughts. Whether you're looking at direct or indirect taxation, whether you're looking at transfer pricing as part of direct taxation, A, the law is in evolution, B, the law is uncertain, and C, even the best experts have absolutely no clarity in terms of where we are going with many of our tax issues. And therefore, I think we have a confluence of A, unaddressed tax issues and litigation of the past, and a whole new generation of tax litigation which is going to come about. And in the context of that, you know, what is it that you as a entity, as a corporate, as an individual who is a professional, what is it that you will look at and what is it that you can really bring as value? It is Arun who introduced me to the word VUCA. I didn't understand it. It took my children to explain it to me. Because apparently it means volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and anxiety. And I think we suffer from all of that as we sort of talk of tax. But let's look at what this scenario today is. If you look at the latest statistic which has come to us from the Ministry of Finance for 17-18, the quantum of litigation, and if we look at Supreme Court, High Court, ITAT, likewise, Supreme Court, High Court, and ITAT, both for direct and indirect, and we are talking of lakhs of crores here. The one situation is that year after year, this image remains completely unmodified. If at all the numbers are increasing, if at all the complexity is increasing, if at all the pendency is increasing. And in that particular background, when you look at the factor that we are talking of almost collectively something like 10,000 cases in the Supreme Court on direct and indirect tax, and if we talk of the rate of disposal of these tax cases, then at best we are disposing of 3 cases a week. I'll leave it to you to do the calculation in terms of how long it is going to take for us to just go through the Supreme Court litigation. And of course, every piece of litigation in the High Court potentially could go to the Supreme Court, likewise in the ITAT. So that really is the background we have. Now, in that background, we have situations where, of course, the government, who is the inevitable litigant in every tax litigation, has taken some steps to say that at certain monetary limits, there shouldn't actually be litigation, and you should only litigate above that. So let's look at a situation of, when do you go to the Supreme Court? You go to the Supreme Court for every tax issue above a crore of rupees. If you were to translate that internationally, your situation is that you are likely to go to the Supreme Court every time that you have an issue in excess of $130,000, which means that almost every major tax case ultimately is going to end up in the Supreme Court because of the threshold that we've set. We've had other situations where, let us say, the department has tried its best to really work on the factor of saying, can we reduce litigation? And let's look at one of those measures. So the CBDT action plan to reduce litigation says, we are forming a scheme. We want to incentivize a CITA to dispose of appeals, which is 3,20,000 appeals. We want to introduce the concept of passing a quality order. And if you pass a quality order, then in your rating, you get 2 extra units. And your quality order, enhancing an assessment, strengthening the assessment order, and levy penalties on such order is how you define a quality order. So what is it that you are actually saying? The ratio at which you succeed at the level of an assessing officer is almost non-existent. Then you go to CITA, which is supposed to be the first independent forum. And in that first independent forum, you tell the officer, if you pass a quality order, I will effectively incentivize you, which really means that in the normal course, I didn't want you to pass a quality order. But now I'm telling you, please pass a quality order. And a quality order is one which strengthens the assessment and increases the quantum of tax and the levy of penalty. So if this is the premise of what is a quality order, then very early in the day, we are really marking adversarial territory where we are saying that the department's interest is revenue, the assessee's interest is to resist paying revenue, and in the entirety of that system, we have to ask the question, where is justice? Because in that whole process, what you really have is a tug of war of revenue, and if you have a tug of war of revenue, what is the quality of the system that we are creating? If you see the recent trend in tax litigation, let's see in indirect tax, you know, what is it that is affecting people? You already have one generation of litigation in GST, whether we are talking in terms of the advance ruling, whether we are talking anti-profiteering, but let's talk of potentially what will be the biggest generation of litigation in GST. We apply the customs valuation rules, which are rules which have only been applied to goods till today, as the basis of valuation in GST. There is no country in the world which has used customs valuation to value services. Far less a situation where you have tried to value supply concepts which have included issues like barters, like exchange. So as we look at it, customs valuation, which was to value goods, is our basis of how we will use valuation in GST. And what is the history of customs valuation? It came in 1988. We had a first avatar of it in 1963. We then had 1988. In 1988, the nature of litigation, where if you have goods, you look for like goods or similar goods. We've had litigation from 1988 unresolved for 30 years. So let me just give you the two most common litigations in customs valuation. One, can you say that one 2000cc car is actually similar or identical to another one? You can think of 15 brands and immediately in your mind, you know that these are not comparable. At this time of the day, probably a more interesting debate that we've had in customs valuation is one 12-year-old Scotch whiskey the same as another 12-year-old Scotch whiskey. You've had 30 years of litigation on this issue, 30 years of unresolved litigation. And that is the law that we have turned to say, I want to make this the law of my valuation. You talk of situations where barter exchange, consideration is an essential element for levy. If you don't have consideration, I will presume consideration. I will look at proxy considerations. I will look at alternate methods. Treatment of composite supplies. We actually had a situation recently in the solar panels case where the advance ruling authority passed an order to say that the definition of a work supply is that it must first, of a works contract, is that it must first be a composite supply. The order passed is that it is a works contract, but it is not a composite supply. You would say that you've put the whole law on its head, but that order effectively in some form or manner gets endorsed by the appellate authority. So you have transitional credits as an issue. Today you heard on the panel that that is going to be a large and ongoing issue. Anti-profiteering, a completely new basis, because the one factor is, if you believe price is only a determinant of reduced tax or increased credit, what are we talking about in terms of Macut factors? Suppose my essential ingredient was petroleum. No matter what you tell me, you've reduced tax. No matter what you tell me, you've enhanced credit. If global price of petroleum is in the direction it is, where do I have an opportunity to reduce price? You talk of cement, you talk of steel. On what premise can you say that these are the only two factors which will determine whether there is anti-profiteering or not? So this is A, the current set of issues that you already have in indirect tax, and we know we will get more. Likewise, in the context of direct tax, we heard in the previous panel significant in terms of presence. We heard in terms of intangibles. You have ongoing issues in terms of marketing intangibles. You have allocation of AMP expenses. You have business connections. You have taxation of royalty. You have a new, entirely new era of tax litigation, where if you don't want to litigate within the system, we are the only country which has four BIPA tax issues. In the entire history of BIPA, from 1959, you've had only two tax issues. In India, in the last 36 months, we've had four. So you see people moving into alternate streams of litigation. And as you look at this, of course, the silver lining is that we have the map, we have the advanced pricing. And from that perspective, you know, we are seeing at least some avenue where you can get some sort of certainty or clarification from the process. But by and large, these are the issues which are out there. Let me talk of the list of the Supreme Court last week. List of the Supreme Court last week. What are the issues which are listed? 2008 issue on the status of 100% EOUs. Next matter, the Sanofi matter in the context of indirect transfers. Next matter, the matters in terms of entry tax and the impact of the full bench judgment. We still are grappling with our 2009 generation of issues. We are in 2018 and we are on the cusp of two entirely different laws, both indirect tax and direct tax, and the time that it will take to settle those down will create, of course, another generation of litigation. So in this particular environment, what will be the potential influencers of tax going into the future? Clearly, BEPS, before it settles, is going to go through its own hunger pangs. And do remember one thing. You may have BEPS as a global law. You may have transfer pricing as a global law, customs valuation, WTO. But the Indian interpretation of a global law is purely municipal. And in our system, we seem to generate litigation, whereas in no other system do you generate even, I think, one-tenth of that litigation. So one, BEPS otherwise may be benign, but what will be BEPS in the context of Indian administration? You are seeing, through technology and otherwise, far greater coordination between different tax regulators in India, between different regulatory authorities in India, between Indian regulators and foreign regulators. The confluence of all of this information being available to your tax regulator is in itself going to influence the next generation of litigation. More than ever before, customs and transfer pricing are now being faced off against each other. Simple situation. You might have a situation where you say, I have incurred this AMP. They will say, what is the reason for your incurring the AMP? You will effectively say, well, I had a price adjustment. They'll say, bang. You win in transfer pricing, but on customs valuation, go out and face a 1,500 crore demand. Because if you had a price adjustment based on an obligation that you have, you might win in transfer pricing, but then you ought to lose in customs valuation. Every one of these issues is becoming more integrated. The other situation is the greater analytics, the greater artificial intelligence, the greater the analytical skills which enable tax officers to look at tax trends, to look at credit trends, you are going to see more litigation. And the overarching thing here is businesses are not getting simpler. Businesses are getting more complex. Physical presences in businesses are disappearing. You have presences really in the alter world. And from that perspective again, to all of this, business complication is again going to be another influencer in terms of where we are going to go. Let's talk about BIPAs. Why do we have four BIPAs? Let me very simply state this situation. If a nation feels, or if an entity feels, that it cannot get adequate recourse in the Indian system, either fast enough or robust enough, if they can be an international investor who can go into the BIPA, they are going to go into the BIPA, as we are seeing, on two very simple premises. One, that there is not a fair and equitable treatment that they are getting. Two, that there is expropriation, especially when you have retrospective amendments. Now, we had the fracas that we had with our retrospective amendment in Vodafone. All four cases are attributable to that. Did we learn from that process? Did we say that retrospective tax amendment is now behind us? In fact, when we had the GST panel, we had a statement for government saying, of course, we are still doing retrospective, but some of them are beneficial to the assessee, which by implication says some of them are not. And therefore, if we still continue to say that retrospective amendments are part of the system, then increasingly, we are going to see actions like BIPA continuing to multiply. What is going to be the impact of what we're seeing in terms of data and analytics? We have an unprecedented number of assessees, far more than we've ever had. 1.14 crores or 1.2 crores, as was mentioned today, in GST, corresponding increase in the number of taxpayers in terms of income tax. Everybody is in the system. Privacy issues apart, as Supreme Court deals with them, you have data on businesses. Now, if you have data on businesses, if you have data on transactional patterns, what we are going to see is A, greater data analytics, more artificial intelligence, greater exchange of information inter se tax authorities, locally, globally. But let's just see how this is playing out in GST. So one, we have the tax footprint we have. Department is actually now monitoring on the basis of A, are you availing more credit than you used to? Are you in a month paying less tax than you used to? Every situation of yours, either in terms of the trend of tax payment or the trend of taking credit, is actually being tracked. And if it is being tracked, you are also being tracked vis-a-vis your own data, you are being tracked vis-a-vis your competitors, and you are being tracked vis-a-vis geography. All three are parameters that they are going to look at to determine whether you are paying what is the expectation of the optimal tax that you should be paying. And in that nature of things, the factor of you now being subjected to the most efficient investigative mechanism that the tax department has ever adopted is another game changer, because previously we had what we might have thought of as brick and mortar intelligence. You waited for somebody to give you information, a competitor, a whistleblower. You waited to see trends as played out, where statistics appeared every 3 years or 5 years. The system now moves to say any deviation in a matter of seconds can cause you to have an intimation from the department to say, why haven't you paid? So given the influence of this, and when we talk of, you know, this whole concept of the VUCA of tax litigation, I mean, every one of these parameters, if you want volatility, you have it. You want uncertainty, you have it. You want complexity, you have it. You want ambiguity, you have it. And overall, that means that this word might actually have only been invented for the Indian tax system. Every aspect of this you can relate to. What is it that really typifies India in terms of its unique challenges? And if you see the first situation which is problematic, many tax regulators, if not all, interpret and administer based on a revenue target. And the moment you interpret and administer based on a revenue target, you are administering not in terms of the tax which ought to be paid, but you are administering on your desire of what you have to collect to really meet your targets. The second issue, every issue of interpretational divergence in India actually becomes a dispute. There is no scope for settlement. There is no scope for dialogue. Officers are, in fact, scared to get into that position because motives may be attributed to them. So from that perspective, every interpretational divergence is a dispute. Now, in many global economies, the culture is that if you have an issue, you should sit across a table and resolve it. Time after time, we have international clients coming in and saying, but why can't I go and resolve this? And the fact that the system fundamentally misses a trust-based situation where you can talk to your tax collector to say, hey, maybe I got it wrong, hey, maybe you got it wrong, but the solution for us is we can dialogue and we can effectively get rid of this. That as a system just is not part of our DNA. Therefore, every relationship between the assessee and the administrator is adversarial. It was spoken of in the last panel. Whether we like it or not, we operate from a trust deficit. Every approach is a suspicious approach. We have investigations which are aggressive. You are called at Friday for a statement. You go, first thing you ask is, not will I get a cup of tea with my tax administrator? You first call your lawyer and say, anticipatory bail milega kya? You can't be in a system where you go to a summons saying, bail milega kya? Your situation is, in every country, if they want to record a statement, they will call the tax manager. They will call the supply chain guy. In India, they know that if I write an email to say that the global CEO from Atlanta must come and give a statement, tax will get paid tomorrow morning. So freely, last year, there is a recorded situation of 43 global CEOs being caused, given a summons to say, come in the next week, give a statement on customs valuation. Global CEO of some of the largest companies in the world. So your investigative process, again, is becoming a tool for you to recover. Pre-issuance of show cause notice, you want to be paid. Now, if you do not even articulate a cause of action, you are talking to a listed company, you are talking to an MNC, on what premise can they pay you without even a show cause notice? But that trend is present and escalating. Quite clearly, at the stage of adjudication, nobody sees a sense or has any hope of really having any success. 99.99 may also be an understatement in terms of the fact of the number of cases that you are bound to lose in adjudication. Also, you could win at the tribunal. It's the final fact-finding authority. But every case which is over a crore is going to the Supreme Court. Therefore, the normal life of a litigation over a crore of rupees is anywhere between 6 to 14 years. 6 to 14 years. But in 6 to 14 years, what is the impact of interest? Interest actually operates to say that 100 rupees of demand could end up as 325 rupees of demand. Why? Because even if you have the best case in the world, you run the risk of that 325 rupees coming, and you have to make provision for it, you have to explain to the global office why you have it, you have to have your accountants convinced of it. So if 6 to 14 years is the life of a litigation, then you are in a situation where you say, am I just better off paying? Because I don't want to take this risk. You're now getting, as I said, to a completely new generation of litigation, transfer pricing and customs. Show cause is almost coming simultaneously. Heads I win, tails you lose. If transfer pricing you succeed, I'll get you in customs valuation you win, I'll get you in transfer pricing. Somewhere in between, if you have the good sense to win both of them, then, you know, in any case, I won't give you your money back. So the situation here is, you had these issues. But of the recent past, you are seeing an escalated issue. The typical pattern in large matters is, a tax issue gets followed by a FEMA notice, especially if it is about payments that you have made abroad. Typically, therefore, income tax followed by FEMA, FEMA followed by PMLA, and PMLA effectively followed by the factor of saying that now that you have the three of these, and how do they bring in PMLA? Normally, you should not be able to bring in PMLA for tax because you are not a scheduled offense. But I have seen two proceedings in the recent past where they say that if the longer period of limitation is invoked, it's an act of fraud. If it's an act of fraud against government, I will invoke CRPC. And if I invoke CRPC and IPC, it's a scheduled offense. If it is now a scheduled offense, then the tax amount is part of the fruits of a scheduled offense. You are liable to PMLA. So this trend, you know, fair enough, we had our own issues dealing with tax, but now FEMA, now PMLA. The other situation is, at least four or five clients have come back to say, previously, India was an island. People said, India litigates, you know, it didn't matter. But of the recent past, the Indian tax issue gets picked up in South Korea. It gets picked up in Turkey. It gets picked up in US. And then the situation is, a situation which was settled for years, which was benign, which was not troubling you, suddenly an India issue starts contaminating your global tax position. What is it that you do when you say that, you know, my tax demand is 100, my interest cost is now 300, and I'm going to also have a penalty? The cost element is literally increasing every day. every day of any delay in the Supreme Court or the High Court is ultimately building an exponential liability. What does that do? Even in the best of cases, I would think that once a week I get a query saying, yes, we have a superb case, but should I just pay because I want the interest clock to stop? I am willing to make a compromise, even in the best case, because I cannot afford the cost of this litigation. And, you know, you have, again, a situation where you have criminal prosecutions for the purposes of tax cases. Previously, the law was that the criminal prosecution would be stayed till the tax issue was determined. Then Supreme Court effectively turned around and said, no, both can be in parallel. And now they are saying that the criminal can actually proceed faster than the civil. So your situation is whether you have a tax liability or not, in the parallel you could be facing a criminal case. Given all of this, two other issues that I really wanted to highlight. One is, let's look at our Income Tax Act, 278E. I argued this recently outside of India. And the situation was, what the Income Tax Act says is that if for the purposes of a criminal prosecution, you need a culpable mental state, namely, you have, for example, an intention to evade tax, under 278E, I can presume the culpable mental state. The onus is on you to show me as assessee that you didn't have the culpable mental state. Now, the law globally is that in a criminal matter, I must show you that I'm not guilty to a standard called possibilities and probabilities. If I show you that probably what I said is right, it's fine. But in this case, the standard is beyond reasonable doubt. So unless, firstly, I presume you're guilty. Second, I say it is your onus. But the onus is that you must prove beyond all doubt that you didn't have a culpable mental state. And the fact that we have laws like this also means that in other foreign jurisdictions, you can get a stay, even against exchange of information, even against tax liabilities, because they just can't understand the standard. You first presume a person is guilty. You tell him, I give you a chance. But you have to prove to me that you are so innocent that I could never have proceeded against you. So the confluence of all of this really means that we are in a regime which is quite unique. Look at your advance ruling. Every state or many states come up with different things. Yes, only the person who applies is covered by the advance ruling. But if I am a manufacturer in the same state, can I afford to ignore the ruling and say, look, I will do what I have to do, irrespective of the ruling? It's not going to happen, because the moment the ruling is there, you are signaling to every assessee that this is a problem you have and this is what you need to do. In solar, Karnataka has one view, Maharashtra has another view, Himachal has a third view. Which is the correct view? Can I go to anybody to get it reconciled? No. Is there a central authority? No. So through this process, I will keep going through the uncertainty of saying what is right. Anti-profiteering. Three cases, three leading MNCs. The original report of the investigator says no evidence. You go to the NAA, NAA says I want you to relook at the evidence. The law allows you to go back in one remand. They have one remand, it again comes back saying no evidence. Next day, NAA issues a list of 62 queries, each one which has already been looked at the lower authority. What about division of roles? Who is supposed to be investigative? Who is supposed to be adjudicatory? Nobody is looking at that division of roles at all. So in all of this, in all of these challenges, what is it that you are going to do to really sort of come out smelling roses? Four or five key issues that I think each one of you who has a tax function or a CFO function needs to look at. The first thing that you need to ensure is a complete synergy and consistency of approach on many fronts. First, what you say in transfer pricing versus what you say in customs valuation, is it fully reconciled? And let me tell you the risk here. If you are telling the transfer pricing guys that I have a lower price and that lower price causes me to spend more on advertising, and in customs you file a form which form effectively says I have no extra commercial consideration and my price is arm's length, Somebody will say, oh, the supply chain got it wrong. Somebody will say the TP executive got it wrong. But imagine you are the managing director of this company. And somebody comes and says, Mr. So-and-so, you're part of an MNC. Your TP guy is telling me X. Your customs valuation is telling me exactly the opposite. Is this not a case, if not of criminal fraud, at least of negligence? And how are you going to answer that question? So the first is customs versus transfer pricing. Now that customs valuation basis will be used for GST, customs versus GST. Then do you have the same synergy in terms of approach against across every business unit and every transaction? We would say that that's the expectation. But the amount of lawyers who build a career on the basis that even the best companies don't follow uniform practices, I think would be in the hundreds. You then need to see what is going to happen in the country-by-country reporting. What sort of synergy do you need between your country-by-country reporting vis-a-vis your Indian reporting, because all of these are obviously going to be looked at very closely. And then you need to look at these three things almost on a constant basis. Your tax position versus your trade competitors. Because in the new age of analytics, it is not that a business practice of company X is going to remain in a way hidden from the tax collector of company Y, who's 2,000 kilometers away. Whether you're company X or company Y, if both of you make toothpaste, you better see that your position is reconciled or you have a very good answer, why not? If both of you effectively sell tires, somebody is out there comparing what each of you is doing. The second situation is your tax position vis-a-vis regulatory amendments. Now let's talk about this. Should you only look at tax amendments? No. Because arm's length price is now a central issue in customs valuation. It's a central issue in transfer pricing. It's a central issue under company law. And it's going to be a central issue in terms of GST. You, when defining what is an arm's length transaction, actually need to draw your cues from the entirety of the regulatory environment which is out there. And the last situation is your tax position vis-a-vis evolving tax jurisprudence. And good luck on this. Because if the advance ruling gives you three views, High Court gives you two views, and then you have to wait 6 years before Supreme Court will tell you what is right, the situation is, in that period, it is critical that you still do not come across as in any form or manner being anything short of 100% credible. So every business to deal with litigation actually first has to create this synergy and monitor this synergy on an ongoing basis. What's the other way to deal with litigation? Let me talk of this transition from what we had as the indirect tax regime into GST. Many significant companies have hundreds, if not thousands of crores of pending indirect tax litigation. But as they have that pending, they've already migrated into a new tax regime. And in that situation, quite honestly, nobody has the attention or bandwidth to deal with that 1,000 or 2,000 crores which is left behind. You will have other direct, indirect. What is the best way for you to actually create for yourself a strategy to mitigate and eliminate your litigation? First, isolate all issues which are similar issues. Second, attribute the amounts that are correlated to each of these. Third, work out the forums where these are pending. Maybe assessment, maybe first appeal, second appeal, High Court, Supreme Court. All over the place, wherever they are. Second, it is not that in every matter you may have the same nature of evidence. Clearly, from year to year, the quality of your evidence will change. It is not that the nature of your pleadings are uniform, because again, depending on year, they may change. Depending on the consultant use, they may change. Depending on the geography, they may change. So again, you need to map the nature of your pleadings. And then you need to map within the entire environment, which other industry has a similar issue and which other industry has something which I can latch onto. And why is this important? Let us say that I had three issues totaling 3,000 crores. So I know it's three issues, 3,000 crores. Let us now say that out of these, many were pending in first appeal, some in ITAT or SESTAT, and then different high courts. Let's say one Bombay, one Delhi, one Nainital. Then I go in and see, is my nature of evidence good in each matter? Because if I have a weak matter and it comes first, then I'll actually have a situation where the earlier weak matter becomes my precedent. Then I see the nature of my pleadings to ensure that all arguments are there. And then I keep my eyes open, does anyone else have a similar litigation? Why is this important? We had a 3,000 crore demand. Same issue, large amount, forums. Now suddenly when looking at forums, we decided and saw Bombay High Court 7 years, Delhi High Court 6 years, but we suddenly did also have a High Court in Nainital. Newly formed High Court, 6 judges sitting, pendency was 30 days. We said, let's go to Nainital. 2 days we watched the judges, they seemed to be very good judges. We took our issue, and luckily for us, Nainital issue was 24 crores. We took the 24 crore issue, argued it for 3 days, we had a judgment within 15 days. That 24 crore matter of Nainital, which then resulted in a very well-written judgment, went to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court dismissed it at the very threshold of admission. Net result, one effort in Nainital sorted out a 3,000 crore issue for us. Because once Supreme Court endorsed Nainital, there was no way the tax demand was going to survive. But the fact that we were looking constantly is what got us here. Nature of evidence. It's key to any situation of yours that the nature of your evidence takes you through. Please realize, and I mean this with no disrespect, most judges are judges because they neither like accounts nor do they like technology. So if you are going to go to him after he has been a judge for 40 years and teach him accounts and technology, he doesn't like you. So a judge gave me fantastic advice once. He says, address me as you would address an intelligent and inquisitive uncle. Make it simple. Tell me things in a manner I can understand. And make me feel I am still the king of the court. The moment you give me principles I don't understand, boss, you are the king of the court, I don't like you anymore. So your evidence needs to strengthen your position to speak to a judge, not to alienate a judge. And what we do is, we create 3,000 pages of reports, the end result of which is that 99%, if you want to ensure your litigation takes 14 years, please put 3,000 pages of evidence. Because that's the easiest way to ensure no judge will touch it. So this mapping is critical to your ability to see how well you can move. Let me take the last issue. We've had issues on customs valuation. We've had issues in transfer pricing, literally billions of dollars. Suddenly we find that before an outstanding judge in Gujarat, some guy is arguing this matter in a 21 lakh matter. 21 lakhs he is arguing it. And when we call him and say, boss, kya kar raha hai? He says, I might withdraw it because 21 lakh hai. He says, which lawyer? He says, koi nahi. I'll brief some local guy. Suddenly this low profile matter, when it comes to Monday morning, sees India's best tax lawyer arrive with a retinue. Because everybody is wondering, boss, 21 lakhs, what has happened that suddenly this has become such an important matter? Mr. So-and-so has turned up from Delhi. What is happening? But we had a clear strategy. That 21 lakhs had to win. Because if that 21 lakhs won, our billions of dollars were going to win. We did win. The fact that we were tracking every player on the issue, and the fact that we chose the one court which was the best court, even though not in our case, but we ensured that the best arguing talent appeared in that matter, effectively sorted the issue. So these become, in a way, the critical points of your own diligence and your own internal etiquette on how you will deal with your litigation. What is the other thing that you have to see which we are, in a way, probably missing right now? Remember always that your first reply is the foundation of your litigation structure. If your first reply is 2 feet, you can't build a building of 200 feet in the Supreme Court. So either your foundation is right or it is wrong. The second situation is, adopt the theory that you are talking to the judge in a manner where he is not an expert, he is not as passionate about this matter as you are. Therefore, three fundamentals. Clear statements, expert evidence which is easy to understand, technical evidence from names he likes. Again, let me tell you the trick. Technical evidence. I have got you a technical opinion from Carnegie Mellon. What? Carnegie Mellon. No impact. I have got you an technical evidence, IIT Kharagpur. Oh, very good. IIT, very good engineers. Come, let's look at your evidence. Don't make the mistake of overstating. You have to win the judge. If he wants to see IIT Kharagpur, please get 7 from IIT Kharagpur. Forget about everything else. So these are factors which will make up the nature of what you can convince. In the phase of investigation, remember one thing. If 3 senior officers speak about the same transaction in 3 different voices, you've lost the matter in Supreme Court. Because the judge is only going to go to that. And we go through this every day. Mr. So-and-so, your CFO said one thing, your CEO said one thing, your tax manager said one thing. If your company doesn't know what they're doing, why should we help you? Critical that each officer knows enough that they speak in one voice. Always the fundamental of everything in the Supreme Court, because everything will go there. The clearer your facts, the greater your chance of success. And actually, contrary to everything you might hear, in Supreme Court, there's only one mantra. Simplicity means success. Don't confuse, don't complicate. But to achieve simplicity, you need to know your matter inside out. So as you prepare a matter, please understand that unless you follow this basis, you're not going to win the big tax matter. Because A, everybody's suspicious of big industry. The moment you talk of a demand of 100 crores, please understand, even today in this country, outstanding judicial scholars who go to Supreme Court and High Court have a salary of 1,25,000. 100 crores is a lot of money. People don't easily pass orders in those cases. You have to facilitate them to write the right order. And therefore, this is your key. If you are talking of your future, if you really want to make an impact in the next 3 years, to my mind, this is your mantra. As a business, map every import dependency you have. Because in the trade war issues, tariffs are going to go up. The cost at which you import your key raw materials will go up. Map your threat in terms of your export potential. Businesses which you conduct with US, businesses you conduct in other parts of the world, those businesses where you export, those businesses are no longer going to be viable because access may be restricted. Your product could be banned. Your product may have to have a value addition you can't meet. Your product may just have a tariff which makes it impossible for you to sell in that country. Third thing, map the risk that either you will be denied access or you will be restricted on access. Map the future trajectory of tariffs. What is going to happen? You have a product which looks very viable at $7, but if that same product now had a tariff which was 40%, at $9.40, can you sell it? No. If you had anti-dumping duty, could you sell it? No. Look at your vulnerability in your home market. It's a reality today. If I want to bring cocoa powder, or make it in this country, if I make cocoa powder in India, the tariff is 33%. If I import cocoa powder from Indonesia, it is zero. It is easier in this country to sell cocoa powder from Indonesia than to manufacture it in Gurgaon and sell it in Delhi. 33% is the difference. How many products are affected by that issue? At this point in time, 124. Your government is negotiating preferential tariffs which you have no idea about. And those preferential tariffs could ensure that Thailand can sell into India cheaper, Indonesia can sell cheaper. Now, unless you map all these issues, there is no way that you are going to be able to tell your stakeholders that you have a sustainable business. Why am I talking about this in tax? Because these are trade issues. But each of these will become a customs issue, an anti-dumping issue, a local levy issue. Therefore, you will have tax litigation on all of this. And look very closely at trade remedial measures. What does it mean? Anti-dumping duty, safeguard, etc. One of our iconic businessmen taught me one day a lesson I will never forget. They make a certain textile product. It was going into US. US starts the anti-dumping proceeding against all the major suppliers, South Korea, Thailand, India, Indonesia, Turkey. We were all scared. US proceeding, massive levies, we are going to die. We were like, we'll need 60 days of this work, 70 days of that work. He pulled me out from the meeting. He says, what is anti-dumping duty? I said, for 5 years, we will get a levy. For 5 years, we will not be able to sell into this market. We'll become uncompetitive. He says, is that really anti-dumping duty? Anti-dumping duty is all the competition in the world is going to be targeted. If I can convince them that I should get 5% and everybody else should get 15, then this market is mine for 5 years. I said, yes. So he says, then don't worry about anything else. Get me 5, but ensure they get 15. Now, these are issues which are going to completely metamorphosize your business. These are the key factors over the next 3 years, where in addition to tax, which you're already facing, these are the issues which will determine customs, which will determine market access, which will determine cost at which you deliver product. And if you are really somebody who's doing a value add to your business, that's a part of what you really should look at. The other thing I think that all of you as professionals owe your company is elimination or mitigation of penalty. Because bad enough, I pay tax of 100, I also pay a penalty of 100. And it's easy to mitigate, it's easy to eliminate. If there is a contentious or interpretational issue, take a credible legal opinion. But don't take a convenient opinion. Everything that the department will argue against you, ensure that every one of those issues has been addressed by your legal opinion. Once you have that opinion, no longer period, no penalty. Second, if it's a contentious issue, engage with the department in writing. Don't hide an issue, share an issue, because if they change their mind today, you are forewarned. If they change their mind tomorrow, you have no penalty.